Science continues to move forward, and the last 30 days have seen a whirlwind of new discoveries. So here's a selection of 10 interesting new scientific discoveries for August of 2024. Number 10, the solar microdrones. Drones are everywhere today. They're used everywhere from military battlefields to recreational flying to police chases. This will continue. Drones are set to only grow in their presence in future years. And indeed, they have also been miniaturizing. You can buy very inexpensive remote control ones that are very small. But what if we could make them even smaller and power them with the sun? Solar-powered drones already exist, but they aren't small. And it's very difficult to shrink a standard solar-powered drone because the smaller you make the solar panels, generally the less power you have for your rotors. But a new drone actually gets past this by getting rid of the standard propulsion systems of drones entirely. The new drone, weighing in at just 4 grams, can stay aloft using solar power and an electrostatic propulsion system. Essentially, components efficiently alternately attract and repel through alternating charges in a ring, and that can turn a propeller. This research, done in China, ultimately has the potential to create very small drones that can stay aloft using solar energy basically indefinitely, offering all sorts of possibilities for their potential uses, for better or worse. Number 9. The Meltdown-Proof Nuclear Reactor. Nuclear energy has always been problematic on a number of fronts, but one of the most dangerous is the danger of a meltdown in a nuclear reactor. The stuff of horror movies. Nuclear meltdowns have been a threat from the start, and they certainly happen. But it's always been suggested that a meltdown-proof reactor is possible to create, and now researchers in China seem to have done it. While older reactors can't be retrofitted this way, only new purpose-built reactors could make use of this technology. Still though, the problem with existing reactors was really heat. You can have situations in a reactor where the heat simply gets out of control. Hence the meltdown. This new reactor, known as a pebble bed reactor or PBR, gets around this by shutting itself down if coolant power or some other accident happens. This can happen because it does not make use of standard fuel rods, rather pebbles of fuel, basically a pebble of uranium coated in graphite. This means net lower energy density. So heat can actually distribute around the pedals, slowing the meltdown enough that the heat can be more easily handled. Hard to say if it's really foolproof, but interesting. Until recently, last year, there were only test reactors of this type in operation, to promising results, but now an entire plant running on this concept is up and running. Testing of the system has shown that it is indeed safe, much safer than the rest of our current reactors. And should now provide a way forward to safer nuclear reactors. Number 8. Bees can slap ants. Honeybees have always been known to defend against ants, and for that matter humans, but in a different way. Oddly enough, bees have even been shown to fan their wings to try to blow ants away from the beehive. But now scientists have seen more. Japanese honeybees will actually go to physical battle with ants. Footage from high-speed cameras show that the guard bees, which congregate at the entrance of the hives, actually will go further with their wings. As an ant approaches them, they have been observed to begin fluttering their wings, turning around and then smacking the ants away from the hive. The researchers studied different types of ants and the success rate of the guard bees against them, and it depended on the species of ant. Against several different types of species, the defense worked about a third of the time. One larger, faster species of wood ant, however, was able to get past the bee attacks with more success. Ants are not defenseless themselves and are known to bite and even kill bees, so it's a two-sided war. But it's not so hard to envision why bees evolved the ability to fan ants away without contact, but also the ability to effectively put the smackdown on ants with their wings very rapidly. Perhaps before the ant has had time to react. Number 7. And then there are the ants. To balance things out, we now know something new about ants as well, and it's a strange one. They have what can only be called a very primitive form of medicine, in the sense of a kind of apparently intentional surgery. It's been known for a while that ants seem to treat the injuries of other ants, and seem to understand that a substance some species secrete can help in healing. And in fact, it's antimicrobial and can prevent infection. But that's only some species. Other ants cannot secrete this substance, so a team in Germany looked into ants that cannot. Studying Florida carpenter ants, they found that ants seeing other ants in distress from a leg injury would go in and amputate the damaged leg. Further, they would only do it if the injury was on the upper part of the leg. Apparently, the lower part isn't worth the risk, or isn't seen as an injury. Further, the ant undergoing the amputation seemed to understand and did not struggle against it. It turns out the mortality rate of the amputee ants in the study dropped dramatically by 90% when compared to a control group kept from doing it, probably due to infection mitigation, so the amputations were effective. The battle of the bees and ants continues. Number 6. Galactic gas leaks. A somewhat obscure unsolved mystery, or a group of them, in astronomy may now have some light shed on it. The first problem was our modeling. As far as anyone could tell, the universe actually should have more gas in it than it seemed to, according to the models. The problem is that it was difficult to really get data on cold gas in the universe, so no one really knew how much of it was out there. It turns out, more than was thought, and maybe due to another mystery. The other mystery is why supermassive black holes are so powerful. It seems they are blasting out gas further than anyone knew, because it too is not actually predicted by the main cosmological models. But the effect is there, and it turns out the missing gas may be out there after all, and isn't concentrated so tightly around galaxies as was expected, but is more diffuse and much more difficult to detect. New techniques are being employed to help see this gas, but it could actually solve another long-standing mystery in cosmology, the missing baryon problem. It may simply be that the matter is out there, it's just been pushed out so far that until now we had no way to see it. Number 5. The moss that can live on Mars. It's always been said that nothing from Earth could survive on Mars, but that's actually a misconception. At least with the microbes, which is why NASA has taken great care to sterilize its landers, because there are bacteria here on Earth that could at least withstand the surface radiation of Mars to some degree in a dormant state. But as far as larger organisms, there actually are some candidates that might be able to do it as well, though nothing we have could thrive there. And now we can add a new one to the list. Known as Centrichia caninervis, it's a moss that grows in some of the harshest conditions on Earth, including Antarctica and the Gobi Desert. That's still better than Mars, but researchers put the moss through a series of tests that gave surprising results. They stored the moss at negative 80 Celsius for 5 years in a completely frozen state in liquid nitrogen. When they thawed it, they were able to get the moss to regenerate and essentially come back from the dead. Further, they subjected it to 500 grays of radiation, and it actually helped it regenerate. Only till the radiation rose to 8,000 grays did damage occur. They then put the moss in conditions simulating the Martian atmosphere, 95% carbon dioxide, and fluctuated the temperatures from negative 60 Celsius to 20 Celsius, introducing high levels of ultraviolet, and to top it off, low atmospheric pressure simulating Mars. The moss went dormant, but even after 30 days in that environment, it still woke up and regenerated when returned to normal Earth conditions. How it could regenerate and operate on Mars, however, is unclear. It very well cannot, but you could leave it on the back doorstep of the Mars colony and bring it back to life. How that would be useful on Mars is unclear, because we can't eat to this moss, sadly. So it remains unclear what could be done with it. Number 4. How the mammoths finally died. Regardless of what killed the mammoths, so far as we know, their final stand was made on an island in the Russian Arctic, where a small group of mammoths ended up sometime around 10,000 years ago, probably as a result of post-ice age shrinking ice, and they got stranded. There was definitely a herd left there, but may have only been as few as 8 individuals. But a population of several hundred, between 200 and 300, developed from it. Then, mysteriously, they went extinct about 4,000 years ago, and that marked the final end of the mammoth, not all that long ago in human terms. Scientists in Sweden looked at the DNA of 14 of the Wrangel Island mammoths, and it showed that the obvious cause of extinction they expected was not really the case, inbreeding. Starting with such a few individuals would cause problems, but apparently they had enough to purge any serious genetic problems when they disappeared, and it was likely not the cause. It would have been a problem if it had lasted many generations longer and there was genetic disease present in the population, but it wasn't that bad yet. Strangely, while environmental change was probably the chief cause along with genetic issues, it did not seem to be drought, which actually got another isolated group of mammoths over 1,000 years before. Whatever it was, if things had been different, Wrangel Island still has fresh water and probably still could be supporting this mammoth population today if they had survived. It seems that the mammoth was a hair's breadth from lasting quite a bit longer than it did. Number 3. Scientists want to drill 5 kilometers into the moon. It's not what you think. Yes, plenty of planetary scientists and geologists would absolutely love to drill into the moon. And no doubt if this experiment goes through, that will all piggyback on it. But this idea is different. Very different. One of the great mysteries of particle physics is whether the proton eventually decays. Some scientists say that it doesn't, as does the standard model. But there is room for another interpretation where eventually, after immense amounts of time, it does decay. Which, if it does, tells us how the universe will end. It will simply slowly go away in the unbelievably distant future. Physicists in Italy are trying to see if the proton does indeed decay, a holy grail in science that would yield new insights on a great many things. And to do that, they propose looking at the moon for evidence of the decay products of protons deep inside very dense lunar rock that underlies the surface. These rocks should preserve mineral evidence of this, under about the best shielding possible, 5 kilometers below the surface of the moon, lowering the chance for false positives. It would then have to immediately be analyzed on the moon, bring it back to Earth could contaminate it, and see if there is any evidence of the decay of the proton. Number 2. A new time zone for the moon. A little known fact is that any mission with the intent of landing on the moon has faced a problem, and it's general relativity. Moon landings are mostly done through Newtonian physics, and that certainly will reliably get you there and on the ground, good enough. The problem is it won't quite get you where you think you should be. And when you get there, you may have to avoid boulders, which happened in the Apollo missions. So NASA has always been concerned about this. Precision is actually really key if you want to nail a really safe place to set humans down on the surface of the moon ahead of time. The reason for this is because the moon is actually a really good proof of general relativity. Time actually ticks slightly faster than it does on Earth in the moon's relativistic frame of reference. The moon has less gravity, which is important in relativity, and that produces a notable deviation in what you would expect when you get there to land if you just go by Newton. You won't be where you thought you were going to be exactly, just almost, and when you get there, not really a problem for the most part when you're trying to land on a very smooth former lava field. But if you're going to try to land in a crater, you need more precision. So NASA is trying to come up with a time zone for the moon that corrects for this. It pays to note that this deviation is really, really small. To accumulate a single second ahead of Earth time would take an astronaut 50 years on the surface of the moon to accumulate it. But it is a problem in navigation. The GPS system of Earth has to correct for this already, and now there's a plan to do it for the moon. How this new lunar standard is going to shape up remains to be seen, and it may not be universally accepted by all countries looking to do further lunar missions. But it does represent one little known but actually very important accuracy issue for lunar missions, especially those with people on them. Number 1. That time Earth was exposed to interstellar space. Alright, this one is weird and I fully expect to be making JMG videos on this one as things develop over the next 20 years about this. Yes, I will never retire. So this is one of the stories that is in a very preliminary stage, but it gives me the chills nonetheless. So the solar system, as it moves through the galaxy, encounters what could be called turbulence or clouds, not unlike an aircraft. In this case, about 2 to 3 million years ago, the solar system may have collided with an interstellar cloud known as the local ribbon of cold clouds. This interstellar cloud formation exists, and is, from our perspective, now located in the constellation Lynx. The thing is, we may have once hit it, according to data from ESA's Gaia satellite. A lot of work here needs to be done, but the idea is that when that happened, it should have shrunk the heliosphere just enough, forced it back enough, to actually expose Earth directly to the interstellar medium for as long as 10,000 years. And this aligns with something. Scientists see from this period a mysterious deposition of plutonium-244 and iron-60 in multiple places on the planet, from the ocean floor to Antarctica and even in the lunar soil, all of which are products of distant supernovae that aren't really being deposited now, but are trapped in interstellar clouds. This is important because that cloud could have led to an increase in hydrogen in Earth's atmosphere, something that no longer occurs in huge quantities. And while it wouldn't have lasted long, Earth can't gravitationally hold on to hydrogen, it may have changed the climate enough to cause different evolutionary pressures than what would have normally been present here right at a time when we were developing as early hominids. But not Homo sapiens yet, we came later. There may be a reason for that. This is all highly speculative based on that finding, but it's possible that this event was some sort of catalyst for hominid development, and for that matter, a number of organisms on Earth, that ended up with an intelligent, technological civilization on Earth showing up in the aftermath, the only one this planet has ever known, as far as we can tell. But had that event not happened at exactly the right moment, human civilization wouldn't have happened at all. And this may not be here without that event. Speculative, I stress that emphatically, and not a lot of facts are known yet, but what can be said is we may be seeing a potential great filter here that we had no idea existed before. And if it pans out, it's going to be a solid one. Stay tuned. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about the bee and ant war. That's been going on for millions of years with no end in sight. Very unsavory, the insect world. I take a grim view of it all, but at least honey is tasty. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.